My name is David Steensma. I'm from the Dana-Farber Cancer Institute in Boston, Massachusetts. And I've just published a paper describing clonal hematopoiesis. Clonal hematopoiesis is when blood cell production is dominated by a single clone, a single group of cells that differ from the inborn or germline conformation in that they have a mutation or mutations that mark them as distinct. A clone of cells is an expanded population of cells that, unlike a clone in, say, a colon, which was going to cause a polyp, doesn't have any anatomic consequence because it circulates in the blood and is diffused throughout the bone marrow. But it occupies an outsized proportion of the bone marrow compared to the amount of blood cell production, the amount of hematopoiesis that any given stem cell should account for. This is one of the most interesting discoveries in the last 20 years in hematology and really in the biology of aging, because clonal hematopoiesis is extremely common as we age. By age 70, more than 10% of the population will have a subtype of clonal hematopoiesis called clonal hematopoiesis of indeterminate potential. This is clonal hematopoiesis of at least 2% variant allele frequency, i.e. mutation burden, associated with a mutation in a leukemia driver gene. The most common leukemia driver genes involved are DNMT3A, TET2, and ASXL1. All of these are involved in epigenetic patterning or chromatin remodeling, and therefore in gene expression. By age 85, more than a quarter of the population have these mutations. These mutations are important clinically for two reasons. Number one, they confer about 1% per year risk of developing a hematologic malignancy, such as myelodysplastic syndromes, myeloproliferative neoplasms, acute leukemia, or less commonly, lymphomas or other lymphoid disorders. More importantly, however, having a clonal population confers a significantly increased risk for cardiovascular events and for death from heart attack and stroke. The death rate is fourfold in patients with mutations compared to those who don't have a clonal hematopoiesis population, who don't have a CHIP population. This is a similar order of magnitude to cigarette smoking or to hypercholesterolemia. It's not something that we know yet how to intervene on, other than to control the patient's known cardiovascular risk factors, such as high blood pressure, diabetes, cholesterol, cigarette smoking. But in the future, I believe that we will treat clonal hematopoiesis with anti-inflammatory drugs in order to decrease the inflammation in the blood vessel walls. Because we've learned that what these clonal cells do is interact with the vessel wall, with the endothelium, and cause inflammation that then accelerates the progression of atherosclerotic plaques and therefore causes those plaques to rupture and block the blood vessel and cause a heart attack or stroke. If we could intervene in some way to reduce the inflammation or to decrease the clonal population, we could potentially prevent these events. And that's not unrealistic. A number of different cardiology laboratories have turned to investigating this as a large proportion of their research effort. Clonal hematopoiesis also takes place in different contexts besides just aging. For instance, after a person is treated for a solid tumor, a woman for breast cancer, a man for lung cancer, or prostate cancer, or what have you, if they have evidence of clonal hematopoiesis at the end of that treatment, they have a markedly increased risk of developing myelodysplastic syndrome or leukemia down the road, usually associated with a mutation in the TP53 gene. In patients who have a bone marrow failure syndrome called aplastic anemia, clonal hematopoiesis can mean one of two things. Some types of clonal hematopoiesis associated with the PIG-A, B-Cor, and B-Cor-L1 genes mark a patient as having a relatively indolent or slow-moving disease course and a high likelihood of responding to immunosuppressive therapy. In contrast, the CHIP-type mutations, such as DNMT3A, ASXL1, TET2, and leukemia-associated mutations, such as RAS, if they develop in a patient with aplastic anemia, then there is a higher risk of going on and developing secondary MDS or AML. Finally, clonal hematopoiesis can persist after a person has been treated for acute leukemia. And we've learned that some forms of clonal hematopoiesis, the three CHIP mutations, sometimes called the DAT mutations, DNMT3A, ASXL1, TET2, if they are the only mutation present at the end of initial treatment for acute leukemia, the patient is much less likely to go on and develop a recurrence of that leukemia compared to someone who has other types of mutations that are still present. Of course, the best case scenario is not to have any mutations detectable at all, but we used to think that any mutation was a bad mutation, and we now know that it's different degrees of bad, that some are actually much more benign than we had previously recognized. And that may influence, for instance, choice about which patients should undergo stem cell transplantation. There is a proportion of people who have clonal hematopoiesis who are older and do not have a leukemia-associated driver mutation. They still have a decreased survival compared to the age-matched controls, and we don't exactly understand why this is. It may be just a result of stem cell attrition as a person ages. It may be a result of a leukemia driver mutation that we don't know about yet. It may be a result of epigenetic changes that can mimic a leukemia driver mutation. But there are now several studies that have shown that clonal hematopoiesis is quite common as people get older, even among those who don't meet the diagnostic criteria for CHIP, for clonal hematopoiesis of indeterminate potential. This is an exciting area of biology because inflammation has been known to influence outcomes of many different conditions, and we may find in the next few years that the presence of clonal hematopoiesis may influence the risk of developing a rheumatologic condition or of degenerative conditions such as Alzheimer's dementia, or it may influence the effectiveness of immuno-oncology treatments such as the immune checkpoint inhibitors. So there's a lot of research going on right now trying to understand these different associations, and I think we'll see many more high-impact papers in the next few years. Thanks for your attention.
We hope you found this presentation from the content of Mayo Clinic Proceedings valuable. Our journal's mission is to promote the best interests of patients by advancing the knowledge and professionalism of the physician community. If you are interested in more information about us, our homepage is www.mayoclinicproceedings.org. There you will find access information for our social media content, such as additional videos on our YouTube channel or journal updates on Facebook. You can also follow us on Twitter. More information about healthcare at Mayo Clinic is available at www.mayoclinic.org. This video content is copyrighted by Mayo Foundation for Medical Education and Research.